Well, The Conjuring is one of the most terrifying supernatural horror movies of all time. Do you remember that opening scene? That demonic doll. It was nightmare stuff. And what is even scarier is that the film is based on a family's real-life experience. It was Andrea Perron's story, and Andrea joins us now from her home near Orlando in Florida. It's nice to have you with us, Andrea. I hope there are no spooky people in your home right now. Listen, for those who haven't seen the film, in 1971, you, along with your parents and four sisters, moved into a charming old house in Harrisville on Rhode Island, unaware that you were not alone. How much of what we see in the film is actually true?
Well, we moved in because my mother found this beautiful farmhouse to raise her five young daughters. The real story in my trilogy, House of Darkness, House of Light, is so intense that Hollywood wouldn't touch it. The Conjuring is based on the case files of Ed and Lorraine Warren, who investigated the house and came to it five times over the course of a year and a half. But we lived in it for 10 years. They were terrified to tell the real story. In fact, one of the producers said, what would be the point of making a film that no one stayed to watch till the end?
Sounds like the line we've got you on is haunted at the moment, Andrea. Just tell us, what exactly happened at this house that you lived in for 10 years?
What happened is that we moved into a farmhouse that was really, well, I describe it as a portal cleverly disguised as a farmhouse. There was so much activity in the house and so many spirits. And when you think about it, eight generations of one extended family lived and died in that house, and some of them never left.
Because you were young, you never considered it was a figment of your imagination. You really believed all of this happened. And what was the most frightening moment for you?
Well, the most frightening moment was the night that the Warrens showed up at the house, and they had a whole entourage of people. They had a priest, a medium, cinematographers, an audiographer, and they insisted that my mother was being oppressed one step away from possession, and that we needed to have a seance in the house so that the medium could determine who the culprit was that was haunting and taunting her, so that she could dispel that spirit from the house. The Warrens admitted that they were in over their heads long after this occurred, but my mother almost paid with her life that night. As far as I'm concerned, what the medium did was spiritual malpractice. You don't go into a supremely haunted house and throw open wide the doors to the netherworld and invite everything in so that you can determine who's causing a problem. The medium ended up collapsing unconscious on the table. My mother was picked up and thrown from the middle of our dining room to the center of the parlor, and everyone that was present in the house that night heard her skull hit the floor, and we all thought we saw her die that night.
And even when your family bought the house, the previous owners told you to always leave the lights on at night. Why was that, and why did you go through with it?
Well, because my father did not know how to interpret what Mr. Kenyon was saying. As far as my dad thought, Mr. Kenyon, the owner of the house, was warning him, you know, bringing five little girls into this enormous house with only one bathroom on the first floor and us all sleeping upstairs. My father interpreted that as a warning not to let your kids come tumbling down the stairs at night, to leave the lights on so that they could get around this very old house that was new to them. And it wasn't until later, when we began meeting people in the area, that we understood why Mr. Kenyon had said that. And that was because he knew there was activity in the house as well. And I believe that in all the decades that he and his wife lived there, she had died about 6 to 10 years, I believe, before we moved in. And he was there alone. And I think he was trying to forewarn my father that if he left the lights on at night, that it would hold the spirits at bay. But that did not turn out to be the case with us. They were active 24/7.
it does sound terrifying. Tell me, in all those years, was there ever any scientific evidence of what was happening?
Well, I consider our experience, each one of us individually, the seven members of our family, to be empirical evidence. In fact, I had a quantum physicist review my books, and he only wrote one line, that it's empirical evidence of the existence of the fourth dimension. Now, if you presume that I didn't sit in front of a computer for 7 years of my life to the exclusion of all else to concoct a big, fat, elaborate lie and then force my family to memorize it, if you're assuming that my family is telling the truth, then our experience is empirical evidence. And yes, we've had much scientific evidence compiled since then as well. There have been numerous people, different investigators, some extremely well known, that have investigated the house and have come away with film footage that is shocking.
And you've written, as you mentioned, extensively about this House of Darkness, House of Light, a trilogy about your haunted childhood. Is there anything more to come from this, or is that hopefully the end of your interactions with the paranormal?
There will never be an end to my interactions with the paranormal. I have day-to-day experiences, as do everyone in my family. I mean, once that door is opened, it never closes again.
Well, I can certainly say that Channel 10 is still haunted by the ghosts of Yasmin is getting married. The real Ghostbusters of Australia conference is taking place this Friday until Sunday. For more details, you can head to melbourneevents.net. Andrea, thank you for terrifying us.
Thank you, Andrea.
And talking to us. We really appreciate
and
it.
Avoid all goals.
My pleasure, truly, to join you. I look forward to the Paracon. I think it's going to be phenomenal in every conceivable sense of the word.